Peace be upon you all and welcome to this first lesson of our introductory course about the theory of evolution. In this lesson, we will understand first what is the theory of evolution and why it is a matter of so much debate. So let's go. So let's start by looking at the observations that we have related to the living creatures. Number one, living creatures have great similarities to each other. So birds look like birds. Tigers, there are many different kinds of tigers, but they are tigers. They look like each other. Fish have great similarity to each other, etc., etc. But we notice something else, that those different creatures that have great similarities also have variations, for example, according to where they are. And we notice that this variation makes that creature very fit to its environment, very fit to its habitat. There is a third observation, that the more we dug the ground and we go to deeper and deeper layers, and those deeper layers correspond in our mind to older and older time, and we find what we know as fossils, and those fossils are essentially skeletons of very old creatures. We have the observation that the deeper you go in time, the simpler the creatures generally become. So looking at all of that, there was a need for a theory that explains why living creatures have those features. So Charles Darwin proposed the following theory, that the reason for the great similarities between creatures is that they are coming from common ancestors. And the reason there is fitness of those creatures to their environments is because there is a force of nature known as natural selection, which essentially means that an organism that is more fit in a certain environment has better chances to reproduce, and the ones that have better chances to reproduce become dominant in that environment and kick out the ones that do not have the same better chances for reproduction. But how would the ancestors develop into all those varying creatures? It is because there is variation between one generation and the next generation. And the more you go deeper in time, the more you go into layers and layers of this family tree, of this ancestry, and essentially you will, according to him, reach at the end a single common ancestor for the whole tree. And let's call this the least universal common ancestor. And Darwin proposed that God breathed life in that first cell. It's a unicellular organism, and out of that, the whole tree of life unfolded. So the picture is like this. There are generations after generation. From generation to generation, there is variations, and those variations between the different siblings are under natural selection, and natural selection in the different environments causes each population in an environment to be more fit to the environment, because only their variations that make them more fit are selected, and hence creatures diversify. And as time passes, and as the environment changes, the variations also introduce complexity, and the complexities that also introduce fitness advantages get selected, and hence life gets more and more complex. Now, this is the story. Before this story, people used to think that creatures were independent creations and that the way they look were fixed. But Darwin came and said that the observations, especially the observations from the fossils, suggest that there is this time-related change, and that this time-related change suggests that this family tree, this tree of life, exists. Darwin did not know about genetics, so the mechanism by which this variation takes place was not very clear until the 60s, where the genetics and the double helix and the DNA were discovered, and then we have an understanding why a creature looks a certain way or has certain features. It's because his genes are creating his design. There's information in the genes, and this information makes the creature look the way it looks. And then we understood also from Mendel, much earlier than that, that there are specific mechanisms that govern the inheritance of the traits or the features between from the parents to the children. When genetics was discovered, then this matter of variation that Charles Darwin proposed, and with our understanding of inheritance, then the theory of Darwin needed to be rewritten, because we knew that variation in genetic code through the mechanisms that we know about, like inheritance, is limited to the features that are already in the genetic code. So if somebody has brown hair and his wife has black hair, then their kids, if there is only the black and the brown features of the hair in their genes, the kids can only have black or brown. You will not get, for example, a brunette or somebody who is blonde. And due to this, there was a need for a mechanism that will justify the new things. So if you're starting from marine animals, if you're starting from fish, and you end up with terrestrial animals, and then you have birds, then you need to justify how gills became lungs. You need to justify how scales became skin. You need to justify how fins became limbs, etc., etc. So there was all this novelty that needed an explanation that is beyond the normal mechanisms that we know about. The inheritance, the selection, and the drift, all of those will select from the existing features. And hence, there was this proposal that the primary mechanism that is introducing variation is random mutation. And random mutation means copying errors that happen during reproduction. And those copying errors will generate the variation. And then natural selection will select the errors that give benefit. So in short, the theory of evolution is like this. There is universal common descent with modification by random mutation and natural selection. And we can consider this statement to represent what is known as modern synthesis or Neo-Darwinism. It is the combination of the idea of Charles Darwin of common ancestry and the effect of natural selection with our understanding of genetics, proposing that random mutation is the engine that generates the variation and natural selection is the force that picks up the variations that give an advantage, and still that the whole tree of life will end up to a single universal common ancestor, which we call LUCA, the least universal common ancestor. Where is the problem? The problem is that random mutations are random. They are errors. So the whole point of contention with the theory of evolution is not that there is diversity, is not that there is similarity, is not that there is change over time, because those are observations, those are facts. Some call these the fact of evolution. But this is not the contention. The contention is, the difference in opinion is whether the theory of evolution is the proper explanation for those facts. And why is there contention about this theory? It is because of the invocation of random mutations as the main driver, and the assertion that the whole tree of life, including humans, including plants, including animals, including fish, including birds, all of them, single-celled organisms, multicellular organisms, fungi, microbes, everything goes down to a single universal common ancestor. I hope that this introduction has given you an idea about, number one, what are the facts? Number two, why did we need a theory? Number three, what was the original theory? Number four, how this theory was edited after we understood genetics. Number five, what are the mechanisms that this theory proposes to be driving life? And number six, why there is controversy around the theory of evolution. So join us next lesson where we explore more about those mechanisms, starting with random mutation. If you have questions about the content of this episode, please do send me the questions according to the instructions in the description, and they will be answered in the Q&A session. Don't forget to subscribe and to share this episode with whom you love and those who are interested in this topic, and see you in lesson number 2.